things that you can only get by praising God, by truly praising Him and worshiping in Him. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. So if you have it there, Psalm 84, and we're going to just read the whole chapter. Now don't get scared, it ain't but 12 verses. And we're going to be all right. We're going to make it through this, and maybe. And if not, it'll turn into a series. Okay? And so, verse 1 of Psalm 84 says, "How amiable are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts! My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth, for the courts of the Lord, and my heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God." That makes me want to shout right there. "Yea, the sparrow hath found an house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house, they will still be praising thee." Selah. And that word Selah means stop and pause and reflect on what you just heard, because it's going to connect to what you're getting ready to hear. And verse 5 says, "Blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, in whose heart are the ways of them, who passing through the valley of Baca make it a well. The rain also filleth the pool. They go from strength to strength. Every one of them in Zion appeareth before God. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Selah." There it is again. "Behold, God, our shield, and look upon the face of thine anointed. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand somewhere else. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walketh uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man who trusteth in thee." Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you once more, Lord, for being in your house. Lord, we thank you for the praise and the worship that's taking place here already, Lord. And Father, we're not done yet, Lord. We've still got a ways to go, Lord. And my hope is that we could learn some new principles about praise, Lord, so we could just do it more often, Lord. I just pray that you would send your Holy Spirit into this place, Lord, and just flood our souls with your presence and your power, Lord. Open up our hearts to receive the message that you've prepared, Lord. And as I talked with you this morning, I told you that this message that I've studied and went over, I just give it to you, Lord. And how you give it back to me is how it'll come out of my mouth, Lord. If you need to change something, you change it, Lord. Just let the words that come out of my mouth be not mine, but yours, Father. Now bless our time together, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Oh, praise and worship. When we think about praise and worship, we think about what just happened up here. Music and singing, and that's praise and that's worship. But I'll tell you what, it's so much more. Now, I love music, don't get me wrong, but there's a lot more to worshiping the Lord than just music alone. That's just a part of it. But, you know, a lot of people think that worship is optional. You know, you can come in church and just sit in the pew and leave and everything's fine. But the Bible says worshiping God is your job. He's called you to worship Him. So it's mandated. It's mandatory that you worship God if you're one of His children. Worship is required. And let me tell you, you know what? The thing about worship is that I pray in my heart that we can have an attraction to worship. You know, that's what he said in the first verse here. The psalmist had an attraction to worship, because what did he say? "How amiable, how great is your house." The psalmist is saying, "I love your house, but your house, your temple, your courts, they draw me there." And we need to have that attitude. We need to have a drawing. You know, I told you last week that the Lord has drawn you here. But you know what? We need to have an attraction to worship. It needs to draw us here. You need to be here this morning because the Lord has drawn you here to worship Him, to pour out your heart in praise, to pour out everything that's in you. And you know, I'll tell you, I'm the world's worst. I was in the shower this morning and I've been playing all the way up past Wednesday what I was going to do. And you know, I know a lot of us here this morning, before we even get through the prayer, you already at the end of the day, what you done in the end of Monday. But you know, we need to come here and leave all of that at home. When we walk through these doors here, we need to have our minds on worship. God has attracted you here. He's drawn you here like a moth to a flame to worship Him. And He wants you to lay aside all the things of the world and come into the spiritual realm. Put your heart down at the cross and give it to Jesus for a little while. Let the world alone. It'll take care of itself. Leave your worries behind. There's enough of them for this day and tomorrow and the next day. Take it one day at a time. This day, this moment, lay it all aside and let's focus on Jesus. He is the reason that we're here this morning. It should be an attraction to worship. But you know what? You also got to have an ambition to worship. You can't, because you know, the devil don't want you here. Anybody have trouble making it this morning? I know y'all didn't. I was the only one having any trouble making it here this morning. If I woke up one Sunday morning and things went good, and I didn't have no trouble getting out the door, I would be scared to leave because I would think something bad was going to happen. But you know, you got to have an ambition. Verse 2 says, in Psalm 84, verse 2 says, "My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth, for the courts of the Lord." The psalmist says his heart is longing and crying out for God. He's got that drawing power. And not only that, he's longing to be in the house of the Lord. Did you long to come here this morning? I mean, did you have the ambition? Now, what is ambition? It's good to have ambition, but a lot of people think ambition is drive for your work. That's a very ambitious person right there. He gets up early and he shows up to work every day. He does his job well. Well, let me tell you, you need to have ambition to worship too. You need to wake up on Sunday mornings and say, "Hey, I'm ready to worship my Lord and Savior. I'm ready to make this day about Jesus. I'm ready to make my ambition to worship my Lord and Savior."
Glory to God. Amen.
The psalmist says his heart longeth. His heart longs to come into the house of the Lord. Yea, even fainteth. I'm dying to get into the house of the Lord so I can worship my God. How many people here? Oh, like the deer panteth for the water. It's what the Bible says. That's how my soul longeth for the Lord. That's what the psalmist is saying. I have a longing to get up in the house of God and get my worship. I need to worship my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I need to be around my people, my fellow heirs to the blood of Jesus, the fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I have the need to be around them. That's what the psalmist is saying. I feel like I'm thirsting and hungering for the Word of God. You know, when you start doing that, that's when you know your ambition is right for worship. Yes, he says, "Hey, my heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." Now that's worship right there. When your heart cries out for God. And you know, so many times I wish other people could feel what was in my heart for God. But you know, you ain't never got to worry about God feeling what's in your heart. He feels it this morning. So everyone that's in your heart, say, "God, here it is. This is my worship. It's right here in my heart. And I want to pour it out to you this morning." Anybody want to do that? Shout amen one time. Amen. And you've got the ambition to worship God. Oh, I pray that all of us would have that ambition. And you know what? We need an attitude of worship too. Worship is not just something you do on Sunday morning. Our whole life should be an attitude of worship. Everything we do should revolve around worshiping God. Even the birds have an attitude of worship. You know, even if you wake up in the morning and you don't worship God, you just wake up early one morning and open up your window. All of creation is worshiping God because they've got an attitude of worship. The birds and the bees, everything that be, all the pollen he collects it for the glory of God. Every song that bird sings, he sings it for the glory of God. Why? Because he's got an attitude of worship. Everything we do ought to glorify God and ought to even the sparrow hath found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself. So even the animals have an attitude of worship toward God. Oh yes, we need an abiding worship too, because so many times when we leave church on Sunday morning, that's the last time we worship. And you say, well, why should I worship? Praise team's up there and I'm gone. And let me tell you, you don't need the praise team to worship God. That's good to have them on Sunday morning. Praise God, we're blessed. But you don't need anything to worship God except the right attitude. You need that abiding worship that comes into your heart. That abiding worship is kind of the same as that attitude. That abiding worship stays with you everywhere you go. Everything you do, it revolves around worship. And that's what it says here. In verse 4, blessed are they that dwell in the house of the Lord, because they will still be praising there. Now this word dwell ain't like you just come in and leave, because you know how it goes, and I praise God for it. Even though service is over, this sanctuary ain't just empty. Everybody don't just run out. We're dwelling in the house of the Lord. We're hanging around, fellowshipping, enjoying each other's company. Our praise and our worship is abiding, just like our presence. Well, you see, that's what God wants. He wants an abiding worship. He never wants it to end. And you know what? You can worship God even on your worst day. Even on your worst day, you can worship God. And we're going to find out that worshiping God releases power from above. Because let me tell you, not only is your worship required, but your worship releases power from God.
Amen.
See, that's the part most people don't understand right there. Amen. Worship ain't just about getting all happy and shouting amen. When I'm worshiping because I want God's power released down on me from heaven. You see, worship releases the strength of God. If you're relying on your own strength, you're out of luck. Because I'm telling you, human strength ain't going to get you there. Verse 5 said, blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, in whose heart are the ways of him. Oh, if your strength comes from this flesh right here, if it comes from that muscle, you're in trouble.
Amen.
You're in trouble. You can't be strong enough on your own to do what God's called you to do. You can't be strong enough on your own to be the man, the father, the Christian that you need to be. You can't be strong enough on your own to be the mother, the sister, the grandma that you need to be. You've got to have strength from God. And if you want to get that strength from God, you got to worship Him. Because when you worship God, it opens up the doors of heaven and strength falls down upon us. Amen. Are y'all receiving what I'm saying? Do you believe it this morning? I'm telling you, when you worship God, there's doors up there that open, and strength and power from above rains down upon us. And you can't get it no other way except praising God, except worshiping Him, releasing what's in your heart to God, surrendering everything to Him. That's when the doors of heaven are opened up and that power and that strength is released. And I'm going to tell you, that's a strength that ain't human strength. That's a supernatural strength.
Amen.
That you can't get from nowhere else.
Amen.
I've heard many times where I've gotten to scenes of accidents. I'm going to give me a towel up in here. Is it just me or? Preach on, brother. Preach on. I've responded to many accidents, and every now and then you respond to an accident where the car's been rolled over. And somebody, time you get there, you say, well, where's the victim? They say, we already got him out. And there's been more than one time when I got there, it was some mighty puny people. And I said, well, how'd you get him out? We picked the car up. We didn't know what else to do. We just picked the car up and got him out. You ain't strong enough to pick that car up. Are you kidding me? You didn't do that. They're like, amen. I know I didn't, but God did. He used me to do it. Let me tell you, God can put His strength in you. What did He do to Samson? Oh my goodness, that man, even in his death, it says in the Bible, he killed more in his death. death than he did in his life. Even though Samson failed God, God repented, and so did Samson. And when Samson repented, God gave him that supernatural strength back. And even though he was bound to them two pillars, he pulled them posts down and the stadium fell down, and he killed more of his enemies in his death than he did in his life. How? God's strength. What was Samson doing? His eyes were gouged out. All his hair was cut off. He just had stubble coming out. He was in bad shape. But let me tell you, he was praising God. They had him on show, kind of like Jesus. He was a broken man, chained up there as a spectacle. But he started praising God, and the doors of heaven opened, and that supernatural strength came down, and he was able to pull those pillars down. Let me tell you, God will give you the strength to pull those pillars down that are coming against you right now. But you got to praise him to get to it. You got to praise God to get to that strength from heaven. Do you believe it this morning?
Amen.
I believe it. I believe it. I wouldn't be up here preaching if I didn't believe it. I wouldn't be preaching if I hadn't witnessed it in my own life. I'm not telling you about something I ain't experienced. I've experienced it. I know about it. Oh, and let me tell you something else. I told you worship releases power from God. It releases strength, but it also, worship releases refreshment from God. Do you know that during this week, some of y'all, I know nobody here don't have this problem, but I've heard tell that during the week, people get beat down. You know, and during the week, this world just attacks them. And they feel like they've been beat down so much that they want to crawl up under a rock and hide. Just beat up by the world. Now, I know don't apply to none of y'all, right? Y'all ain't never had that life. Just want to hide. Oh, it's kind of like, can you imagine if you was in the middle of the desert? And I love them survival shows. Me and Lucas watch Dual Survivor. I think that's what it's called. And they out there trying to survive. And they do some terribly nasty stuff that I ain't gonna tell y'all about. But put it this way. They get really thirsty and they drink some stuff that's bad. But anyway, can you imagine if you was out in the desert? If you was out in the desert and you've been out there for a while, because you can live without food 8 days if you're Baptist, 12. Very long at all. Y'all caught that, didn't you? So, but if you... No, I forget where I was going there. But if you was out there in that desert, you couldn't last long without water. If you was out in the desert and you just happened upon this clean, fresh little brook of flowing water, and oh, how good would that be just to get in there and just jump in and wallow around and drink it. Probably drink it first before you wallow in it. And drink it. You would be refreshed, wouldn't you? How refreshing is it? But you know what? Life does that to us. Our week is like going through the desert, a dry, parched, barren place. And we get so beat down by the world. But when we come into God's presence and we offer up praise to him, it's like streams of living water flowing down from heaven and into us. And that's how Jesus could say that there will be springs of living water welling up from inside of you. In verse 6 it says, who's passing through the valley of Becca, make it a well. Let me tell you about the valley of Becca. It's just like what I just said. The valley of Becca is a real place. And it's there today. And let me tell you, it's really dry. It's a barren place. And what the psalmist is saying is, you refresh me like a well in the middle of the desert. This world is like a desert. But God's power, if you will praise him, he will open up the doors and pour down refreshment upon you and renew and reinvigorate your life today, right now. You believe it?
Amen.
But you got to praise him to get it. Somebody praise God up in this house this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. I give him all praise, honor, and glory because I need refreshment. Yes, it's looking like it's going to be a series this morning. It's looking like it might be a series because I ain't half done. Because God is good. And I want to praise my God up in here this morning. That's why I come. going to stop me this morning. I'm telling you, I'm going to praise Him because I need strength. I need refreshment in my life. Oh, and I need my prayers to be answered. Don't you know that praising God helps your prayers to be answered? Don't take my word for it. The Bible says it. It's not my idea, but verse 8 says, "O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayers." This man is worshiping God. This psalmist has went into God's house, and he's praising Him with everything in him, and he knows God is going to hear his praises. If you got a prayer that needs answered, before you start asking God for something, start praising God for everything.
Yes.
If we would praise God first, before we ask Him for stuff, you're much more likely to get your prayer answered. I like to praise Him in advance for answering my prayer. Because He's so good and He's so faithful. Yes, praising God opens up the windows of heaven for answered prayer to come down too. I'm telling you, God is good. Oh, yes, it helps our prayers be answered. It strengthens us, and it gives us an enduring strength. And let me tell you what else it does, too. In verse 8, it says, verse 9, it says, "Behold, O God, our shield, look upon the face of thine anointed." When we praise God, the doors of heaven opens up, and God puts a shield around our life. Do you know that? I'm telling you, I need God's shield in my life. I got some things that go on where I need to be shielded from this world. Hey, the Bible talks about that shield of faith that will shield us from the fiery darts of Satan. I'm telling you, if you need a shield, you better praise God. You can't find a better shield than the shield He gives you when you offer up praise to Him. Oh, when we praise Him, He puts that shield around us. It's impenetrable. Mm-hmm. It's like in Star Wars when they had that, what is it called? They had a force field around the spaceship and them laser beams. Nothing could penetrate. Well, God's shield is better than that. Satan's power cannot penetrate that shield that God puts around you. And let me tell you, not only will He put a shield around you, but if you praise God, He'll put a shield around your family. He'll put a shield around your loved ones. He'll put a shield around people that you pray for that ain't even in this country. That's how good God is. But first, what have we got to do? To me, it don't sound like praise when you whisper it. I say, "Hallelujah, God, shield me from all my enemies. Shield me from the great enemy, that old serpent, the devil, Satan, Lucifer. I need your shield and your protection. Anoint me with your Holy Spirit." You want to be anointed? You better praise God. That's what the psalmist says. You want God's anointing? You better praise Him. Hallelujah, I'm going to praise Him. I feel it already. Anybody feel the Holy Ghost?
Amen.
I might get through this if y'all got a few more minutes. And I don't die from exhaustion.
Keep going.
If y'all just bear with me a little bit, because I ain't got but a couple more things to say. I believe we're going to get through this one. They ain't going to have to make a series out of it. Let me tell you what I told you already. Number one, worship is required. It's not something that you can do or not do. Worship is required. Worship releases power from God. When you worship and praise God, the doors of heaven open up and power comes down. And the third thing and the last thing I want to tell you is this. When we worship God, when we praise God, it is rewarded. You are rewarded when you praise God. When you worship God, you're rewarded with satisfaction, for one thing. And I know that's the thing in life that everybody's looking for. And so many people are missing is satisfaction. That feeling of contentment. That feeling like you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. I know there are people in this world who feel like like something is missing, and they're not, there's something that they need that they're not getting, and it ain't vitamin D or vitamin E or some kind of supplement you can take. It's something else. What you need is Jesus. What you need is to praise God more, and He will reward you. I'm telling you, He's ready to reward you for your praise if you will just do it. He rewards you with the satisfaction in our life. Verse 10, matter of fact, says, For one day in thy courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. Psalmist says, I'd be satisfied with just one day in your house rather than 1,000 days somewhere else. That's satisfaction. You know, I want to feel satisfied with my life. And you know, Billy Graham passed away this past week. And I believe Billy Graham was satisfied with his life. You know what he said? In lieu of flowers, tell somebody about Jesus. That is a man after my own heart. My spiritual gift, I've got a couple. One of them's preaching, one of them's teaching. But it may be that evangelism is my number one gift. And I believe that's Billy Graham's number one gift too. And that just may be why I talk about salvation a lot. Because it means a lot to me. Because I want everybody I come in contact with to know Jesus and to be saved by Him. It's important. It was important to Billy Graham. He said, in lieu of flowers, tell somebody about Jesus. Share the gospel with one person. And you know what? I believe Billy Graham was satisfied with his life. Because his satisfaction was not based upon worldly accomplishments. He was not satisfied because he was such a great evangelist. He was not satisfied because he was such a great preacher. He was satisfied because he was a child of God. Yeah. And he praised God. You want to feel complete? So many people tell me, Charlie, I feel like something's missing. I feel incomplete. And I ask him, have you praised God today? Well, I didn't praise God about it. Did you wake up this morning? Yeah, you got something to praise God about. We always got something to praise God about. If you woke up this morning, praise God. If you made it here this morning, praise God. Because when you start praising God, the windows of heaven open up and you are rewarded with satisfaction. Oh, one day in thy courts is better than even 1,000 days elsewhere. And let me tell you something else. You're not only rewarded with satisfaction, but you're rewarded with God's sufficiency. We talked a little bit about that last Sunday where He told Paul, my grace is sufficient. But God is sufficient in all things. I am insufficient. Everything about me is insufficient in everything I do or try to do. But by the grace of God, He is sufficient enough in me and through me to make me sufficient. Oh, yes, He's sufficient. When we praise God, we're rewarded with His sufficiency. And in verse 11, it says, truth will spring. Oh, I'm on the wrong page. It says in verse 11, for the Lord God is a sun and a shield, and the Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will He withhold from you. When you start praising God, He starts pouring out blessings. He will not withhold anything from those who praise Him. Do you need something this morning that you ain't got? Praise God. That's a hard thing to do, though, ain't it? When you're in need, when you need something that you ain't got, you want to go straight to ask Him. But I think a better strategy is when you need something, go straight to praise.
Amen.
Go straight to praising God. Say, God, I just want to praise You because I know You're going to reward me by meeting my every need. There's no good thing that You will withhold from me, and I'll praise You for it. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. No good thing. Oh, He will reward us with His sufficiency. We're insufficient, but He is sufficient. And then lastly, He rewards us with His protection. Verse 12. Oh, Lord of hosts, blessed is the man that trusts in You. Safety. Safety is what I think about. He keeps me safe. And I'm telling you, when you're old redneck country boy like me and do stuff that's not OSHA approved most of the time, you need safety in your life. I told y'all about how the garage door about fell on me and took me out. And I got plenty of other stories like that. And if you do it the old farm way, there wasn't no OSHA on the farm where I was. You know, you'd get used to cutting torch and right there with the gasoline. You just do it how you can do it. You need safety from God. And I'm going to tell you, even if you do it the OSHA approved way, you still need God's safety in your life. I pray more for my family to have safety than even me. And God knows I need it. You want safety for your family and for yourself? What you got to do? Tell me.
Praise God.
Let me hear you praise Him one time this morning.
Praise
Him. Yes, Lord, praise God. Let's give Him a mouth. Hey, let's give Him a foot stomping, hand clapping round. Yes, Lord, I believe y'all want to praise God.
Amen.
And I believe He's going to do three things because of that. I believe that He's going to honor your worship because He requires. I believe He's going to release power from heaven down upon you. And I believe that He's going to reward you for your faithfulness. Praise Him. So in this upcoming week, I just pray that you'll remember that. Remember the power of praise for Jesus. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank You so much for the power of praise, Lord. We thank You that You're such a good God that we never run out of praises for You, Lord. We pray that You would continue to honor our praise and pour out power down from heaven, Lord. And we pray You would continue to reward our praise, Lord. Help us through this life and help us to be the people that You want us to be. Help us to be the church You want us to be, Lord. Be with us as we go into the Sunday school hour, Lord, in Jesus' name.